In this video, I'm going to show you how to add unit tests to an existing ASP.NET Core web application. Let's go take a look. So if you have something like this already set up, this is an ASP.NET Core web application. In my case, I have one project called Awesome Website, and that's my website. So if we run this in IIS Express, you can see that it's just, you know, the boilerplate website that you get stubbed out when you make a new project. I really haven't done that much to this application. The only things that I've added so far are a user model and a user service. And this is where I want to show you how to add a unit test to. So this method here I've called filter user by name. And basically what this is going to do, it's going to return a list of the user model. So first name and last name. We can go look at that. So just two properties on that. It's going to take in a parameter of a string and a list of users. And basically, it's going to filter the inputted list by the name that you provide it based on first name. And then it's going to return that filtered list. So I want to add a unit test around this method. And I'm going to show you step by step how to do that. And I'm going to show you every single error and anything that you will run into that will be a problem based on the current version of 2019 Visual Studio, the current version of NUnit, the testing framework that we're going to use, and pretty much all the weird stuff that you have to take care of if you add unit tests after the fact of making a project. So the first thing that we're going to need to do is we're actually going to need to install three NuGet packages. So if you go to Tools, NuGet Package Manager, and then Manage NuGet Packages for a Solution. This is pretty much where you install everything that you need to work with in your project. So if we go to Browse, and again, as you can see, we don't have any packages installed, so this is fresh. This is going to be like you're doing it right now. So the first one we're going to need to look up is called NUnit. And NUnit is one of the most popular unit testing frameworks available. And it's what you may see if you work in a production environment. It's what I use at my job, actually. And as you can tell, 105 million downloads. So it's pretty popular. Before we even do that, I just want to show you, we have to actually add our project to this solution. So if we go ahead and right click and we go to Add New Project, we need to add our unit test project. So what you're going to search is you're going to search class library, and then you're going to look for the .NET Core class library, and you're going to want to hit next, and then we're going to call this unit tests, and this is the project that's going to house all the unit tests that we're going to make. So again, call it unit tests and then hit create. And then as you can see, it made a new project here. And then just go ahead and rename the class of what it provides you. So I'm just gonna add, we're gonna test the user service class I have here. So the typical convention is to basically use the name of the class. So user service, and then just append tests at the end. So user service tests. Go ahead and save that. And then you're gonna have to rename this. I guess you could have deleted this and then just made a new one from scratch, but however you want to do it is fine. So user service tests, and perfect. And this is what we're gonna be using to create our unit tests. And again, let's go back to the NuGet solution package manager. So again, tools, NuGet package manager, manage NuGet packages for solution. So there are five NuGet packages that you should install that are part of the NUnit test library that you'll need to run the unit tests. And some of them are just kind of nice to have, so you may as well install pretty much all five of these in order to run, to kind of protect you against version issues, depending on what version of the test framework you're using, what version of projects you're going into. It would just be nice to have all five of them, just to kind of eliminate some potential issues that you may run into. So the five, if you go to Browse and then NUnit, are going to be NUnit 3 Test Adapter, Console Runner, Console, and the NUnit Project Loader. So you're actually going to want to go through each of those and then click Project for each of them and then install them to the project. We're going to look up Microsoft.NET. What is it called? .SDK. Nope, it was that one. Okay, there it is. Microsoft.net.test.sdk. This is what's going to actually enable us to run the unit tests. If you don't install this and you try to run the unit tests, they're not going to run. They're just going to say not run with a white exclamation mark, and that's not what we want. So we need this guy right here. So what you see me doing here is I'm actually adding the test SDK to the entire project, and that's something that you'll need to change. So now jumping back to the unit service tests, the first thing we're going to need to do is actually, we need to add the using statements for N unit. So an easy way to do this is we're going to add the attribute called test, and that's what you make. You have to add that above every method that you do that's going to be a unit test. So if we mouse over it with IntelliSense, we're going to add the using statement to using nUnit.framework. So now we can begin to make our first unit test. So it's always, or generally it's public void. And then let's actually go back to our user service and go ahead and copy the name of the method that you're going to be testing. Use that method name, put an underscore, and then you describe the action that you're wanting to test. So in my case, I want to do an end-to-end test. Basically, I want to test that the entire method itself works, not just a specific action. So I can actually just use the keyword works. That's one convention that you may see. Again, if you were going to test something specific, let's say like I was going to test if this was a longer method and this had several filters or whatever it was, and I wanted to test if a specific filter was working, let's say like filter by first name was working, I could, instead of using the word works, I could say like filter by first name, something like that. Basically, however you're needing to structure this, the convention is just to use the method name and then underscore and then describe what action you're testing. So that's the structure of how you're going to stub this out. And then the layout of a unit test typically follows this pattern here. So you have your arrange, you have your act, and then you have your assert. And I'm going to explain each of these right now. So the arrange is where you're going to define variables, and the act is where you're going to perform an action like calling the method that you're going to be testing, and the assert is where you're going to run all your assert statements, basically what the conditions are for the test to pass. So the next thing we can do, since we know the method that we're going to be testing, we can actually call that method. But first, before we call the method, we have to make an object to access that method. So one convention that is you'll typically see in a unit test project is you're going to see a setup method. And oh, if I can write the method, you're going to see something like this generally. You may see different patterns of how this is done, but you may see this, and then you're going to see an attribute called setup. Or if you don't see setup, there's another one called one-time setup, but they're kind of similar. So depending on what you need, just do a little research. So basically, this will get called when this unit test project or unit test file is run. So basically, what we can do is we can add a reference to, we can make a new object of user service, and it's going to try to autocomplete me there, but I don't want it to. So we have our user service class here in the awesome website project, and we need a reference to the user service. So if you try to mouse over, and it's going to tell you to add a reference here, but if you're on this version, you can't do it this way because it's going to get stuck on the execute action dialog box. So if you watched a video in the past that I made, I show you a fix for this. And basically, the short of it is that you're going to want to right-click your unit test project, and you're going to want to add, where are you at, project reference, and then you're going to click the project that you want. So I want to add a reference to awesome website and click OK. So once we've done that, we can then add the using statement. So sweet, so we got that. So now let's make our object. So our user service, and then we just declare it, and then we're going to instantiate it here. So we're going to say user service is equal to new user service. And again, you don't have to structure it this way, but this is one way to organize it that you may see in a production setting. So now that we have a reference to user service, we can then call our method. And again, we want to do that in the act section because the act is where we're performing the actions. So if we look back at our user service, this is going to return a list of user. So let's go ahead and make a variable called filtered users is equal to user service. And then let's go ahead and call that method. So filter user by name. And then it takes in two parameters, so a name and a list of users. So this is where the arrange section comes in. This is where we define our variables that we're going to be using. So let's go ahead and var name, and we can maybe just use my name, and then var users. So we're, again, our list of users is equal to new list of user, and we're going to have to add a reference to the user. So just add your references there. And we're also going to have to add a reference to use a generic list. Okay, once we've done that, we can say new list users, and then we can do that, and then we can basically define our list. So first name, since it is going to be filtering by first name, I do want one with my first name. So let's add that user in there. So now, let's add a couple of these users first, though. The reason I'm doing this on one line is because I don't want to take up a lot of space with a bunch of random fake mock data. I will be showing you how to do this a little bit better, though, later on. Maybe not this video. I don't know. So let's just give this a bunch of random data. User 1. User 2, user 3, it literally does not matter what I do here on the last one because it's the last name because it's not actually checking that. So now we have our mock data kind of stubbed out here that we're going to need to test this with. So let's go ahead and pass that in. So we're going to pass in names, our name, and then users into our method. And okay, so what we've done so far is we've added our name variable, users list. We call the method. Now we actually have to check, you know, does it do what we're expecting? So what we are expecting the filter users by name method to do is return us a list based on the filter by first name, you know, if it's equal to the name we pass in. So given that case, we can make our first assert statement. So we can say, you always begin with the word assert, and then we can say, we're given a list of options. And the one that I like to use is the word that, and then you put parentheses there. We're gonna assert that filtered users, so that's gonna be our first parameter. So you pass in pretty much what you, the first parameter that you typically pass into this that method is what the output is of the method that you're testing or whatever it is you're testing against. So in this case, we're testing that our filtered users, and then we can use the keyword is, that's part of NUnit, and then you'll see equal to. And then we're gonna say it's equal to, we think that, or we believe that this list is gonna be filtered by first name. So we can actually make the filter in here. So we're going to need to add a list to the link and let's go ahead and just make the filter real quick. So it's equal to, you know, users based on first name equals, what do we call a name? Okay. Okay. So what we have here is we're saying that we believe, we're asserting that filtered users is going to be equal to the filter that we think is going to happen, right? So we think it's going to be filtered by first name, and it should be. So we believe that this test will pass. So let's go ahead and run this. So in order to run the test, you may need to go to view and then Test Explorer. If it doesn't actually show up in the corner here under me right here, Test Explorer. If let me move myself, Test Explorer right there. So you'll see a list of the unit tests that'll show up, and let's go ahead and actually build the project. And we might get an error when we build the project, and that's what I'm expecting right here. And this is the problem, this is the issue that I wanted to address in terms of something that you may encounter when you install this like this. So it says there are build errors, and then let's go ahead and click no, and let's see what the error is. And it says the program has more than one entry point defined. Let's go back here and let's see what the problem is. So it's going to take you to the program.cs project in your website project that you have set up. And it's really weird, and this really shouldn't be a problem. And if you do a little bit of digging around, you can kind of see what other people have had this issue as well. So basically what you have to do is you have to add something to the CS proj, and I will show you that in a second once I find it. Okay. So you have to add this line to, if you double click the project right here, it's going to take you to the CS proj file, and in the property group, you're going to want to add this line, generate program file is set to false. And basically what happens is in this version of .NET Core, it tries to make a main for the new class you add, and it causes issues for whatever reason. When you add, it causes issues when you add the Microsoft.NET.Test.SDK. I don't know why, it just does in this version, but that is a potential error that you will find. So let's go ahead and add that. Let's build this again, and let's go to our Test Explorer. You can go and right click, as you saw I did already, your test, your unit test. And again, in our case, it should have passed. So we saw it pass, and let's go and take a look at, you know, what it's saying. So we see a green check mark, and we see that our method works. Now, if we were going to go back into the user service, and we are going to filter it by last name, and we're going to run the test again, our test should fail, because we're not filtering on what we think. So we see a red X here, and let's see the summary, and let's see here. So our expected is a list, you know, but we're not, basically our expected is different from our actual. So the reason for that is because in our test method, we're testing that it's filtered based on first name. But in our user service class, we're filtering based on last name. So you can see the benefit of unit tests and see why, you know, they should be used in a production environment and why you should, you know, get in the habit of writing them for each of your methods. And I don't think anybody likes writing unit tests, but honestly, there's something that you should get in the habit of and get in the habit of writing well, because writing good unit tests is very important, because it kind of it makes it a lot more manageable, your project. It's never a good thing if you have a unit test that is hard to read or that tests a lot of things. One thing that you're going to want to keep in mind when you're writing a unit test is that each unit test should be testing one thing. It should only be responsible for one thing. So ideally, in a ideal setting, you should have as few of these assert statements as possible. If you have a lot, you may need to consider what you're testing, and you may also need to consider if you need to break that method out that you're testing against into smaller methods that are more easily testable, because you should be writing code that is easily testable, and you should be writing code that is in small chunks, that is only doing one thing. That's the single responsibility principle that you should probably be following. If you're going to add multiple asserts, you can do that. It's fine. So if we were going to add like assert, you know, that, I don't know, filtered users is not, I don't know, null or something like that. Is not, oh, that's right. is not null. Okay. If you were going to do that for some reason, I don't know. You can do that. So again, you can add multiple certs, but just, you know, question, you know, should I be doing this? Does it make sense for me to be testing as many things as I am? Now, if they all have to do with the one output, that's fine. If they all have to do with that one single responsibility, that's okay. And another thing that you can consider doing is if you run a test like this and this first assert statement fails, this next assert statement will never get run. But a way around that is actually you can do assert multiple, and then you can pass in something like this. And then you can put your assert statements inside that body there. So basically what you're saying is you're going to call each of these assert statements regardless of if the first one passes or not. So now you've seen a couple ways that you can structure your unit test, and now you've seen a couple of different patterns and styles that you can use to implement quality, efficient unit tests that are easy to read and written well. This is just one example of how you can write a unit test and how you can structure a unit test file. Again, if you have to start making these convoluted, complicated unit tests, I would question whether or not your original method that you're testing against is written in a way that makes the most sense or is written in a clean way. And that's really where unit tests come into play, is because it makes you think, you know, am I writing this the best way? Like, I know you can, like, am I writing this in a way that's clean? And am I writing this in a way that makes sense to others? And that's an important thing to ask. And that's an important part of software development, because you're always going to be coming back to that code. So you should write it in a way that's testable and clean the first time. So thank you for watching. I know this was a really long video. If you want to see more content related to unit testing, let me know in the comments. I can do a lot of videos on unit testing. I write them all the time. So I've seen a lot of patterns and styles. You know, I've seen what works, what doesn't. I've seen more technical ways. I've seen a lot of advanced techniques to do that. So I think I might make a series out of this, actually, on how to write clean unit tests. I think I might do that. So stay tuned if you're interested in any of this content. And thank you so much. And I hope this helps somebody out. Anyway, thank you for watching. Have a good day.